Funding for Firing Line is provided by this station and by other public television stations.
It is once again time to turn the tables, the semi-annual opportunity for distinguished liberals, if you will permit the oxymoron, to conduct the inquisition. I am today at the mercy of Mrs. Harriet Pilpel, well known to this audience from previous appearances, in which she specializes in defending indefensible positions. She is a much sought-after attorney in New York, a graduate of Vassar College and Columbia Law School, who has served and continues to do so in dozens of civic, educational, and ideological organizations. She lists herself in Who's Who as, quote, writer, lecturer on marriage and family law, literary and entertainment law, constitutional law, civil liberties, birth control, abortion, and related subjects, status of women, problems of legal professionals, also of communications media, which only touches the list. Mr. Carter Burden served for 8 years as a member of the New York City Council representing the east side of Manhattan, having been elected as the youngest member in the history of New York. He too is a lawyer, a graduate of Portsmouth Priory, Harvard, and the Columbia Law School. He was for a while the principal owner of the Village Voice and of New York Magazine. Defeated for the Democratic nomination for Congress last winter, he is running again for the seat formerly held by John Lindsay and Edward Koch. His principal adversary in the primary is Mr. Allard Lowenstein, who is also familiar to viewers of this program. He last appeared as U.S. Commissioner on Human Rights, from which position he went on to become ambassador at the United Nations, serving under Andrew Young, but not, we will all be relieved to learn, as his ghostwriter. Mr. Lowenstein is a graduate of the University of North Carolina, of the Yale Law School, where he subsequently taught law, as he did at other universities. He has served in Congress and as a political activist, promulgating the campaign of Senator Eugene McCarthy in 1968 during the primaries. He has resigned from the UN in order to compete for Congress in November, always assuming he defeats Mr. Burden in the primary in September. ERA not yet having been enacted, I will follow convention and give precedence to the lady, Mrs. Pilpel.
I would like to ask you a question which really basically has to do with what is wrong with our attitude toward our young people. I read this morning that there are all kinds of very stringent laws being proposed in Albany whereby juveniles will be punished the same as adults. At the same time, we deny juveniles many of the privileges of adults, right to health treatment. The Supreme Court has upheld corporal punishment. We're constantly fighting about sex education. Should they know about these things? There was a recent decision saying that bad words shouldn't be used in children's presence and so forth. It all adds up to me to a lack of a national policy which is to the detriment of our young people, and I wondered how you felt about that.
Well, I feel that there is no national policy, and that the purpose of laws endeavoring to get tougher with juvenile criminals is not so much to punish them, let alone to rehabilitate them, as it is to get them out of the way. And I think this is sufficient reason for new laws, inasmuch as we have had more than sufficient experience with the old laws, which permit people to be repeat murderers at age 16. Until those statistics are accosted in some other and more fruitful way, I think that it is a common and justifiable objective simply to remove them from the streets and put them where they can't kill people.
You sound as if we had unlimited facilities for that purpose, and as if eventually you would face the possibility of putting great numbers, like thousands of young people behind bars.
Well, as many as there are murderers.
Those are very few, but I don't want to monopolize the questioning. I simply reserve the right to come back to some aspects of this question, and I'd like to turn a question over to you.
Bill, I've disagreed with many of your positions, but that's never troubled me. I think we need more of that kind of disagreement. What has troubled me on occasion is what appears to me to be very often inconsistencies in your positions. Specifically, you have rejoiced at the passage of Proposition 13. You've called for similar action at the federal level. You support the Kemp-Roth bill, the Steiger Amendment to reduce capital gains taxes, all of which, especially following the Proposition 13 approach, would significantly reduce government revenues. At the same time, you have called equally strongly for significant expansion in military expenditures. You've called for the B-1 bomber, which costs $100 million per plane, for the cruise missile, which at the very least is a $3 billion program, for the neutron bomb, which is projected at $3.5 billion, and the MX missile system, which I think by conservative estimate will cost $40 billion. And I just wonder whether you're not really trying to have it both ways. You're talking about reducing significantly what government collects and at the same time increasing in one part of government operations, government expenditures in a very significant way.
Well, I think we have very little alternative than to spend as much as is necessary to defend ourselves convincingly. Now, we are now spending 6% of our gross national product to that end. We were spending 13% of our gross national product to that end as recently as 15 years ago. During that period, gross expenditures in the public sector rose, and we were spending three times as much as we were spending 10 years ago on social services, some of which might be considered to be necessary, some of which I consider to be unnecessary. But during that period, whereas there are several points of view as to whether people are socially better off, there is, I think, only one point of view as to whether we're better off vis-a-vis the Soviet Union. The answer is we're not. We are much weaker than they. They're spending twice as much of their GNP, which begins by being half the size of our own, on not defense, but on offense. We know from the fingerprints of their entire battery of assault missiles that they have a first strike plausibility. I believe that the American people want to make whatever sacrifices are necessary to guard the sovereignty of this country. All of the proposals that I have backed would increase the percentage of the GNP devoted to defense from 6 to 8, which is still less than half of what it was 13 years ago. So it doesn't seem to me to be compulsive or irrational.
Well, I wasn't really questioning the merits of a strong defense. I was really just asking whether you can, in fact, cut government revenues by 30% or whatever and still do.
Well, Jerry Brown, who is our new Pujadist, seems to be showing us how.
He had a surplus, however. We have a rather large federal deficit.
He's going to dissipate that surplus pretty soon. But if his rhetoric is to be believed, he is quite confident that the quality of California life will not deteriorate drastically as a result of Proposition 13. This is quite different from what he was saying, mm-hmm. And you and I will both forgive him for that, given his occupation. However, it is correct that somewhere somebody was going to protest what seemed to be an irreversible increase in the level of public spending. It happened in California, where the ham and eggs plan also happened, and the Townsend plan, and lots of other things. And I delight that our federal system makes it possible for us to observe how it will, how one state will fare under such an experiment.
Can I pursue this line without forfeiting my own line? Is that
sure.
Under the rules of this procedure?
Anything that suits you all suits me.
Don't take too long.
I think that the question of limited taxing and spending, having been sort of put, we ought to understand that what Carter's saying, I think, is that federally, if you put that ceiling, then the problem of what you do if there were legitimate increased costs for defense to find the funds for that has to also be dealt with. California doesn't need to defend itself against an attack, presumably from Nevada, but the United States has these international problems to deal with. And how do you apply the principle of limited collecting and spending federally, understanding the complexities that Carter's outlined in terms of weapons needs that you believe are important, that's, I think, really the heart of that problem. I just make that comment to illustrate that one can think that there is great value in the limit of collecting and spending, but see enormous difficulty in applying it federally. That's, I believe, perhaps what Carter was saying.
Well, yeah, there's no equivalent of a Proposition 13 for federal spending. There are people who play with the notion of a constitutional amendment, which would limit federal take to, let's say, 20% of the GNP. If we were in a wartime situation, or in a semi-wartime situation, it would clearly be necessary to expand the division in behalf of defense, and at the expense of postponed dams or whatever. But that we did, of course, in World War II.
The question I'd like to ask goes back to my notion that even if ERA had passed, you could still have selected Mrs. Pilpel to begin the program on the principle that she may be the oxy and I may be the moron or whatever it is, but you could select who you wish to.
You're not allowed to say seniority. Huh?
That we repealed in the House the last time I was there. The question I want to ask, though, is why are you so hostile to ERA when all it really says, as far as I think, as a lawyer and as someone who voted for it in the Congress, what it says is that there shall not be discrimination against people on the basis of sex, except where that is justified because of something that, in fact, is defined by the sex itself. In other words, I don't think that the law ought to discriminate on the basis of sex, because if you do that, what you're doing is you're inflicting discriminatory patterns, whereas there are things where men and women are clearly and should remain clearly different, and that would not be obliterated by an amendment to the Constitution that simply stated that these discriminations could not occur simply because of sex rather than because of other factors which might be reflected in the sex of the person.
Well, if what you're saying is that under ERA you would still have separate restrooms, the answer is that's true.
Yeah. Right.
It is not, however, true, and Professor Paul Freund of the Harvard Law School has stressed this point, just where the division asserts itself, for instance, can you draft a man but not a woman to serve in the war under ERA. This is by no means explicated. So let us agree to begin with that there would be huge arguments between one set of people and another set of people as to what ERA means in a particular situation.
I dispute that.
Just on as there has been on every amendment.
That's right. On every part of the Constitution. Yeah. It would be no more, no less than the problem we have on all parts of the Constitution.
I expand on that by saying, when we freed the black man, when we gave votes to women, we were saying fairly straightforward things, which in due course required amplification. But there is, in my judgment, no necessity to liberate women through constitutional means when simple statutes have never proved inadequate to the task. Well, let's not give to the Constitution a task to do which can be done by individual Congresses is, I think, a fairly safe presumption, for me anyway. However, but let me answer this question because we can get into sort of the Phyllis Schlafly level argument about ERA, and I think some of her arguments are very compelling. I see my principal objection to ERA is that I think it's it is metaphysically presumptuous. It seems to be urging a kind of indifferentiation between the sexes, which I don't think faithfully reflects reality, or even the ideal. By seeking a procrustinization of the sexes through constitutional means, I think it is reaching out to say things that I feel very uneasy about seeing said in the Constitution.
My sense of it is, I think, the opposite, which is that without ERA, we have, courtesy of HEW frequently, and under Republican presidents with Alabama Republican secretaries, we've had the most absurd guidelines issued in the name of ending discrimination, and those guidelines including prohibition on choirs being determined by the sex of the participants, all those things.
You'd have the guidelines anyway.
But my point is that's happened without ERA, and to blame ERA for an effort to procrustinize sexes, it seems to me, is backwards. What I think ERA does, and why I think it's important to attempt to get it enacted is that it would settle once and for all the fact that you cannot discriminate unfairly on the basis of sex, for instance, an amount of money paid for similar work rendered. But it would not then do what we're now doing, which is to fish around through administrative guidelines for a lot of spurious efforts to impose equality, where in fact what we're imposing is an absurd homogenization.
Well, you would need guidelines anyway. The point is, where are they going to come from? Are they going to come from administrative agencies, or are they going to come from the courts? On the whole, administrative agencies are easier to correct than court findings, and much less expensive to do so.
I would like to point out that many lawyers have been of the opinion for a long time that the Equal Protection Clause of the 14th Amendment, which says that no state shall deny equal protection by inference, no, Congress shall not deny equal protection, is precisely the same as the Equal Rights Amendment. The problem is that what you deplore hasn't happened here. The court has not judicially legislated to extend equal protection so that race, so that although race is a suspect category now under the Equal Protection Clause, sex has not been held to be. All that the Equal Protection Clause would do, the Equal Rights Amendment would do, would be to say hereafter you cannot discriminate against either a male or a female because he is a male or a female. That does not in any way interfere with any kind of differentiation you want to draw between people because of their varying capacities to do things.
I don't even want to be told that. I'm a free man, and it seems to me that the burden of society is to tolerate other people's crotchets. If I thought that there was class oppression in this country against women, I would seek remedy by set legislation. I don't see that. But if I want, for instance, to advertise for a female nurse to look after my mother, I would like to be able to do so without feeling that the sheriff is going to come to my door and say I had just violated a constitutional amendment by making that distinction. I don't see why you people are so hot and bothered about it. Let me hire a woman when I want and a man when I want.
Well, I'm so hot and bothered about it because I'm a woman, and it's women who have suffered from unequal treatment according to the kind of things Mr. Lowenstein said, not equal pay for equal work, discriminatory legislation in terms of what they may do and may not do, which has nothing to do with their abilities.
I don't think it is the documented fact that women have suffered all that grievously. Of course, you were without a vote for a while. And you suffered a political disability of a very explicit nature there. But I might remind you that ever since we got hot and bothered about women's rights, the number of women entering the professions has actually declined.
The only thing I want to add, I don't want to take so much on this subject that we get grounded into it, but my concern about it is perhaps not the same as yours, because I think that it is an important amendment to pass for men. I don't see it as a female feminist issue. I think the society now is laden with unfairnesses to both sexes inappropriately. I know that's the case in many marital situations, for instance, and I think that it would be fair to say that one of the virtues of this amendment would be that it would require equity at law on the basis of a society which does not want to inflict homogenization but does not want to see improper discrimination based on an irrelevant consideration as sex is
but
in some situations.
But the trouble is for you to decide that an entity other than the individual America is going to decide what is relevant seems to me to constrict, not to broaden, freedom.
That was the argument on the racial
Yes, it was the argument on the racial business, and I think it was abused. We all tolerate each other's idiosyncrasies. But if those idiosyncrasies took on genocidal form, we would stiffen up the law to prevent it. And they did in the South under Jim Crow, for example. But for an individual who desires to hire somebody because it's a she or somebody because it's a he to do this particular job, to find that there is a law that says, and indeed an article in the Constitution says he can't do it, strikes me as a fanatical extension of the ideal of equality.
I think you should look at the data on the subject of what women earn for doing the same jobs as what men earn. And I think you will find that there is an active need for something which would constrain people to pay the same
work. I believe in equal pay for equal work, which is why I don't believe in progressive income taxation.
Can I get into another issue here of equal importance? I have trouble with some of the recent positions you've been taking with regard to Israel. You endorsed the Saudi plane sale. You wrote a column recently attacking Menachem Begin, calling him intransigent, too militant, not really interested in peace.
Wait a minute, I didn't say he wasn't interested in peace.
You did, in fact. I have the column here.
No, I said he wasn't, he hadn't recently proved that he was more interested in peace than he was in the settlements.
Again, but
I used the same phrase as a member of his cabinet in making that point.
Right. It seems to me you're taking essentially a dovish line, which is a real switch. You are certainly a hardliner as far as...
Dovish line on what?
With regard to Israel. If Menachem Begin represents a hard line, you are criticizing him for being too intransigent, too militant.
Yeah.
I happen to disagree with that, quite frankly. I think that Begin has a real interest in peace. I think in many ways he's been more flexible than Sadat by going further on the Sinai and other issues that really have not been publicized. You strongly feel that the United States should be more inflexible, more militant with regard to our enemies in the Soviet Union, yet you feel that Israel is being too militant with regard to their enemies. And it seems to me that if any country historically has reason to take a hard line, to be very careful, and to look after its own rear end, it is the state of Israel. And I think that you seem to be almost implicitly supporting the notion that the United States itself should be, one, undermining the Begin government, and two, imposing our own notions of what the solution should be on the parties.
Look, I am on record, among other things, as suggesting 5 years ago that Israel become the 51st American state. But this would not permit the fulfillment of certain purposes in that the people who founded the state of Israel had in mind. I don't know who was around before me to recommend that the United States guarantee Israel's borders. I am 100% behind a corporate resolution by the United States done under any form that guarantees the survival of Israel as a state. But I do think that at a period in the evolution of the relationship between Israel and its neighbors, when there have been signs of moderation, Israel unhappily elected a leader by a very narrow majority whose rigidity is out of sync with the manifest efforts by Sadat violating all kinds of anti-Israel taboos in his dramatic gesture of last fall. Every criticism I have leveled at Begin, as I say, is a mild transcription of criticisms that have been leveled against him in the Knesset, including by the Minister of Defense of Israel. So my position is hardly distinctive.
I must disagree because, frankly, we were just there, and I expected to see the Begin government very fragile. I was impressed by, in fact, how strong it was. And indeed, when you say that he has done nothing, if you look at his actual peace plan, he's gone substantially further with regard to the Sinai than even the Labor government was prepared to do.
Secondly, the Sinai is not what people have been arguing about most heatedly. They've been arguing about Resolution 242 and its meaning. It was understood for 10 years as meaning one thing, and all of a sudden Begin reads into it something really quite different.
Do you believe Israel should give back all of the post-67 territory? It should be returned to 67 borders?
I believe that the unanimous resolution of the Security Council was correct, but I believe that Israel has a right not to give it back until its security is assured. This is what we're talking about. But let me point out a further fact.
The question is, can its security be assured if they give it back?
The ultimate security of Israel, in my judgment, is not a factor that's going to be decided by Arabs. It's a factor that's going to be decided by Russians. Because the Soviet Union desires to control the Persian Gulf. It's not going to control the Persian Gulf without incidentally controlling Israel. I was enthusiastic about the beefing up the air force of Saudi Arabia, as I have been of Iran, on the grounds that we need powerful military entities in that area that will help to guard the sovereignty of that area against a Soviet salient, of which, as I say, Israel would be merely an incidental casualty.
See, I have a problem with this Saudi Arabian airplane question that you've focused on because of two things, which I have not seen you or any of the people who supported the deal adequately deal with, and it would be a wonderful moment if you could explain what you would deal with, how you would deal with two aspects of that plane arrangement. First, after Afghanistan and South Yemen, what is it that you say to people who feel nervous and unhappy about having a volatile society near them, equipped with the most advanced weapons possible, knowing that that society may change governments and still have those weapons at that border? I just find it very difficult to understand what you would say to Israelis who, with the history that they've endured, could face overnight the kind of hostility again in Saudi Arabia, a government which even described as moderate has never publicly acknowledged Israel's right to exist. And I just wonder what you say about that possibility.
You say you're running a hell of a risk. We're running a hell of a risk by giving arms to West Germany. After all, we fought Germany twice in this century. Do you realize that the communists almost won the election in France? And yet France is, our outstanding ally in Europe. In the last analysis, one simply has to do the best one can in the historical circumstances. Golda Meir said to me one time, I just love American presidents. The American presidents always tell me how much they look after Israel and how they cherish Israel's security and so forth. But no American president has ever offered me the keys to the Seventh Fleet. And she said, until we get the keys to the Seventh Fleet, we're going to hang on to the Golan Heights. Now, I understand exchanges of this sort. I understand exchanges of this sort. And Shimon Peres said to me, look, it took Americans 25 years before they gave back Okinawa. Why should we give back the West Bank until we have a reasonable chance to achieve the same kind of security? All of this I find absolutely plausible. But I do think that there is an emulsion there, a volatility of a kind that true diplomatic statecraft ought to take advantage of, and that Mr. Begin is not the man to do this. I think that nothing would damage Israel more than to find itself in a situation in which there is no alternative for Egypt than to fight a holy war with its ambition to be the destruction of
Israel. I don't think anything that Israel has done has left to that with no alternative. But I'd like to ask you a different question in this same context. We have supported governments in two countries which do not believe in any of the fundamental freedoms that we believe in. And I wonder,
which one are you talking about?
I'm talking about Saudi Arabia and Iran. There has been a consistent pattern of non-democratic government in both of those countries.
By supporting, you mean selling them stuff?
Yes, and generally considering that they are allies of ours, although they do not subscribe to any of our
theories. In that case, it's right to say we supported 120 countries.
No, but
we sell stuff to the Soviet Union. We are anxious to sell stuff to China.
But you justified what was done in connection with these two countries on the ground that we needed friends there, and Israel needed friends there. But the fact is that these countries do not subscribe to any of the basic principles subscribed to by the United States or by Israel. And I wondered if that didn't give you some moments of disquiet.
I live in a very disquiet world, as Trotsky once said to a companion, if you want to lead a quiet life, you pick the wrong century to be born in. The fact of the matter is, we live in a world in which we have to face such questions as, are we or are we not in favor of a strong Iran, even though Iran has an extremely primitive judicial system, is governed by an absolute monarch? My answer is, I want a strong Iran, because I think that there is workable within Iran an opportunity for improvement. Indeed, there have been trends in the last 10 years, which I couldn't consider to be melioristic. But what we have to primarily guard against is the fact of the Soviet Union, which is the principal global menace. We, after all, made allies with the Soviet Union to fight Hitler Germany, an alliance you did not object to, even retroactively. So if we can make allies with the Soviet Union to fight Hitler Germany, we can certainly make allies with the Shah of Iran to fight the people who just put Sharansky in jail for 20 years.
My problem is not the theory of being involved when necessary with unpleasant governments. If Churchill could say that when Hitler invaded the Soviet Union, that he would at least make a favorable reference to Satan if Hitler invaded hell, I can understand your concern that we not take morals to the point of defeating our own national interest. What is at stake in this question is what is our national interest? That's mm-hmm. really the focus, not whether we should or should not accept unpleasant governments when necessary. And my problem, to finish the discussion we started on the airplanes, is that the tenor of what you have said, what the President has said, is that we want to create an atmosphere in the Middle East in which a kind of new hopefulness can exist for trust. It seems to me oppressively apparent that taking airplanes, which had been promised to Israel in return for a withdrawal in the Sinai, reattaching those same airplanes to another arrangement with Saudi Arabia, a government which has not yet accepted the right of Israel to exist, and saying that for Israel to get planes promised to her earlier, now she must also accept Saudi Arabia having the same degree of advanced technology that most frightens Israel in terms of her own psychology of dealing with the opportunity for a new approach to the problems of the Middle East, that's you just flunk psychology and ignore history to do that, because what happens is you reinforce the sense in Israel that no promise is ever kept, that they have no one to rely on but themselves.
Well, as
doesn't that bolster the whole approach that you're most upset about?
It does, in a way. As Mrs. Goldemeyer said to me, if the United States gets out of Vietnam, it will certainly convince us in Israel that America's word, it can hardly be credited. That didn't stand in your way of recognizing what you consider to be geopolitical force majeure and advocating that we get out of Vietnam.
Yeah, I don't think they should rely on our guarantees. I think Vietnam was a profound experience for Israel.
Yeah,
especially
if it's set up where the alternatives are nuclear war. There are not very, very many Americans, even people running for office in New York State, who are going to advocate a nuclear war for the defense of Israel. I like to think of myself as...
Yeah, that's our NATO policy.
What's that?
That's our NATO policy.
NATO policy does not specify what weapons will be used. And that was one of the things that
we are committed to the initial use of nuclear weapons if we start losing the convention.
We are committed to the defense of... To the defense... All NATO signatories are committed to mutual defense in the event of an invasion. But it does not specify what form that defense will take. And what de Gaulle said 10 years ago is one thing is plain. The United States is not going to use nuclear weapons to bomb Moscow if this means the elimination of Chicago, Los Angeles, Cincinnati, New York, and Washington. Now, let's think forward and recognize that this is a problem. Under the circumstances, we have an interest in containing the war and try to reassure Israel by means satisfactory to its own tacticians. And this, I think, is a requirement of American foreign policy, but one that is congruent with the goal of beefing up all of the countries of the Persian Gulf so that they could provide realistic deterrent against Soviet invasion.
Just to take this one round further, the right that the United States has to pursue a policy separate from Israel's is obvious. Mm-hmm. No one would argue with that. In fact, if we're quoting Mrs. Meyer, I remember one time she told me that when the United States wanted Israel to do something and Israel didn't do it, and she was upset, the American ambassador in Tel Aviv called her up and said to her, Mrs. Meyer, you'll recall that we recognized when Israel was founded your right to sovereignty. We were the first country to do that. I expect you will now recognize our right to sovereignty. And she said that she understood exactly what he was saying, which is that there will be times that the best of friends will disagree on policy.
Abe Ribicoff was forced to say in the Senate of the United States, I feel free to criticize the president of the United States. Shouldn't I also feel free to criticize the prime minister of Israel? The answer was by no means unanimous.
Well, the point I'm trying to make, though, is that recognizing the validity of the separate policies when necessary, we're talking now not about whether that's a valid right, but whether it should have been exercised on the question of those airplanes.
Right. That's right.
And my concern about it is that in terms of the administration's own stated goals, that it, in my view, undermined the possibility of achieving those goals, because what it did was to solidify the sense among many people who were determined to help find a new approach that could not happen if, in fact, the price of it was to increase the military threat to Israel in the event that there was a change of government in the neighboring state.
Well, that is your perception, and I honor it. But I also think that people as attached as you to the survival of Israel believe wholeheartedly and sincerely that its strategic chances are maximized by strong neighbors. And I do remind you that Saudi Arabia did not play an aggressive role in either of the last two wars against Israel.
Can I ask you
they are still funding the PLO to the extent of $50 million
Could
a
I
year.
Change the subject a little bit? We can come back to that if necessary.
Keep it on Jews and get to Sharansky for a moment, because that's
all
something
right.
that we start on, and also it sort of got lost in the Israel thing. But Carter made a very important point, I thought,
you
earlier.
You just took away his time.
Oh, by praising
Carter was about to bring up something.
Sorry. No, that's, I think it's your turn.
Well, if you want to continue with Sharansky, it's all right with me. I just wanted to change the subject because it seems to me that while we're settling foreign policy, there are an awful lot of aspects of domestic policy that are not being discussed, on some of which I would like to know what Bill Buckley's attitudes are. We know, for example, that there are 1 million teenage pregnancies in the United States every year. We know that of that 1,600,000 result in births, most of them outside of wedlock, and 300,000 result in abortion. I have not at any time heard you, Bill, be in favor of sex education, contraceptive services for young people without parental consent, or abortion. So I wondered how you would handle what is obviously a national problem of such major importance that the president, the secretary of HEW, and almost everyone else who studied the problem at all is of the opinion has got to be resolved, or at least has got to be ameliorated in some way.
I love your formulations. It would be the equivalent of my saying, Mrs. Pilpel, I have never heard you discuss double parking, speeding, or genocide.
It would not be the same. I mean, I don't think it's the same because you and I
have discussed these before.
Sex
education and abortion are, let us recognize, qualitatively different. And never mind your enthusiasm for both. I think there's a very good case for sex education, but that the whole question of abortion rests absolutely on a single metaphysical question. As a matter of fact, not only metaphysical, also a physical, scientific question. Is the fetus entitled to the protections the day before it is received from the womb that it is entitled to by common consent the day after? I think that the compelling arguments are that it is entitled to that protection, and that if that is the case, the humane position is to oppose abortion.
I don't for one moment disagree with your right to have that position. I happen to disagree with that position. What, however, bothers me a great deal is the assumption of many who hold your position, not only that they may act in a way that's consistent with that position, but that they are going to make everyone who disagrees with that position act in the same way. For
suppose your personal conviction was that you should be allowed to have a slave, and I would say, no, I'm terribly sorry, I'm not going to permit you to have a slave. You said, but that's my position. If you don't want slaves, don't have slaves. But
that's
meanwhile, I'm going to import a slave. And I say, I'm terribly sorry, this is a matter of social policy. Slaves are human beings. If I arrive by the same processes at the conviction that a fetus is a human being, then I invoke the same protections for it that you do now, that we do now belatedly for slaves.
But there is no consensus or major body of opinion behind
that. That's why I want
a
consensus.
Therefore, I ask, what are the members?
There was no consensus about slavery for a long time.
But leaving that aside, what are the members of those groups, Protestant churches, Jewish, many others, who feel, for example, that abortion is not only something which should be, which can be used in certain circumstances, but should, mm-hmm. as a matter of political, as a matter of religious conviction, be used in certain circumstances? Why is it fair for the group that disagrees with that?
I think they're morally backward.
But it's your privilege to think that they're morally backward.
It was John Brown's privilege to think that about those people who defended slavery, and Abraham Lincoln's privilege to be ahead of his time.
But you have no right to impose that position, do you, on those who disagree with you? It is forcing a minority view on someone else.
Let me ask you this. Suppose it was 1850, and I had got up on the floor of the Senate and said, I propose a law outlawing slavery, and somebody said, you have no right to promote a position that is distinctively yours.
I am not challenging your. I have not challenged your right to promote your position. I would fight to the death for your right to promote your position.
You wouldn't want that.
I am just saying that I do not know how you can justify imposing that position on others who do not share it.
Well, by the same way that the abolitionists ended up imposing their position on the South, they had to do it through war. I certainly don't anticipate war in this instance. But I think it's safe to say that more thoughtful people oppose abortion now than 5 years ago.
Have you any basis for that statement?
Yes.
Because I think it's safe
yes.
to say the
growing
that the
list
contrary
of the growing
is true.
List of scientists who more and more endorse the notion that the fetus is a viable human being.
That is a metaphysical question, which is the way
that's a scientific question.
You first described it as a metaphysical question, which is what I believe it to be. In any event, you and I and the people that agree with you and the people that agree with me will never agree on that. But what we could agree is that the role of the government in this kind of dispute, in a culturally diverse, pluralistic society, is to be neutral and not to adopt your point of view.
My God, you just want to pass a law saying that I can't hire a woman nurse for my mother, and you're telling me that the law has to be neutral as regards matters of such gravity as abortion. Talk about consistency. Why don't you shoot at her, Carter?
Well, on consistency, what is your position on the death penalty? Do you support the death penalty?
I rather like his formulation about that. I don't like the death penalty, but I think that the death penalty, I think that the arguments against the death penalty are progressively discredited as crime, savage crime, mounts, and the figures tend to fortify the notion that it is a deterrent.
But if life is sacred, and if that is a basic moral premise, how can you then, in any case, justify
by reading the Bible?
Life? An eye for an eye. You ascribe to that?
No, I don't ascribe to that. But there are many instances of the Bible in which the taking of a man's life, given due process and given the gravity of the crime, is authorized. And certainly,
the Bible does not deal specifically with abortion.
It has been practiced in countries that follow every known faith.
The reason why capital punishment has been discredited in this country, at least in part, is not whether we subscribe to the philosophy of an eye for an eye and tooth for a tooth, but rather that an analysis of the figures of those who have suffered capital punishment has revealed that they are always the poor and usually members of minority groups, and therefore that capital punishment as it has existed here is a discriminatory form of punishment and therefore should be abolished for that reason as well as for all the other reasons.
Well, why don't we say we can have capital punishment only for rich whites? How's that?
That's being facetious.
Well, I intend to be facetious because it's the only way to cope with you sometimes. The arguments for capital punishment are not discredited by the fact that capital punishment is impartially administered any more than the arguments for law are discredited by the fact that only fairly wealthy people can hire lawyers in many instances.
I've never understood the notion, I still do not understand the notion, that people who can understand the validity of taking up arms against Hitler or other times involving themselves in what results in the loss of human life suddenly become what amounts to pacifists on the question of capital punishment. I think it's absurd to say one's for capital punishment as if there's something virtuous about killing somebody, whoever it is, but that we were engaged in a great moral struggle to protect some high principle when the man in Utah wanted to end his life as part of his understanding of what he had done. That seemed to me to be one of the most extraordinary extensions of moral hypocrisy and fervor for no purpose whatever.
But most people who are condemned to capital punishment do not feel the way the man in Utah felt, and they do not want capital punishment imposed upon them.
No, but that isn't the point.
Most people who were murdered would just not be murdered.
Right. Well, let me just finish on this point, which is not to say that I am minimizing the complexity of the sociological unfairnesses to poorer people in our society or to people of minority races, which are very, very important social causes that we should all be aware of and work on, but I do think that to use that as a grounds to say that there are not circumstances under which capital punishment is of a lot of unacceptable and unattractive options, the one that is necessarily to be taken, I just don't see that. I don't see it as a great deterrent, but I do see anyone that says to me that Eichmann should not have been put to death has to explain to me why not, and I do not understand how you can say you're against capital punishment as an absolute unless you're prepared to take that position. So my view of it is it's a spurious issue. It becomes emotionally very supercharged, where people take sides and polarize, whereas most people of intelligence would agree that capital punishment's a terrible thing, that the sociological situation producing a disproportional number of poor and minority people suffering extreme punishment, whether it's death or incarceration or whatever, that that's a goal that we ought to work to change, but that finally there has to be some recourse to capital punishment under certain circumstances, and that we ought to then get over this polarized argument and move to the great questions that that drowns out.
Well, I think that what you've said all falls to pieces, frankly, although I should leave it up to Bill to say this, I'm afraid he won't, by reason of the fact that there is absolutely no evidence or data to indicate that capital punishment is a deterrent to murder, and most murders...
I'm not advocating it.
Let's just say that if
you will read the last books of Professor James Q. Wilson and Ernest Vandenhagen, they will give you the sources.
Well, but to some extent, those authors assumed their conclusions. And there is a great deal of data to the opposite effect.
They discredited.
I don't think that the argument of capital punishment rises or falls the deterrent question unless you can explain to me why it was in the interests of humanitarian concerns to allow the people who murdered the Israeli athletes at Munich to not be put to death for that crime. I do not begin to understand that reasoning. Deterrent or no deterrent, I find it very difficult to understand that approach. And
I find it difficult to understand how you can discuss the general question of capital punishment in terms of a series of specific cases. I mean, one might agree with you on a specific case without regard to the generality of the situation,
no,
but that doesn't mean that overall
but then you're agreeing
capital punishment is not a bad thing.
I think we got into this basically in terms of it being a moral question, or if it is a moral question, and its relationship to abortion. I wanted to ask you, Bill, since you've been an admirer generally of the Nixon appointees to the Supreme Court, how you feel as a journalist about the Zerker decision last May, which essentially upholds the right of the government to search a reporter's notes.
I thought it was unrealistic. I think it's one of those frequent decisions that one sees written by judges who have manifestly no palpable experience with what it is that they are doing. for them to apply legislation to newspapers. Let me put that more exactly. For them to authorize, in respect of newspapers, that which is perfectly plausible in respect of sausage factories, tends in its effort at impartiality to work crudities, injustices. And I think in due course it will be revised.
I don't think you're essentially a liberal with regard to journalists' sources and notes.
Because I think that you began with an unfortunate cleavage, because most of the decisions that are indefensible for reasons of abstractionism by the Supreme Court are made by pre-Nixon appointees.
Now, the concurring justices were Berger, Blackmun, Rehnquist, Powell, and White, who's the only pre-Nixon.
Yeah, I say most of the decisions that rest on abstractionist bases, i.e. or unreal, are decisions made by the Warren Court, which had no Nixon.
Well, you have a perfect example of a decision made by the Berger Court in the case of that little, what is it called, that little worm in the TVA. Yes. I mean, you have criticized the court for legislating and not adhering to the literal words of statutes. I think you have a perfect example of what happens if you encourage people.
They said that's the law. The Supreme Court said exactly the correct thing there, didn't they? They said, we've got no explicit interest in a snail dart. But this is, in fact, what that piece of legislation says. So go back and rewrite the legislation.
Yes, but you see, the legislation didn't say the snail dart. It talked about endangered species in general, and the court was there for the purpose of deciding what answer was the correct one in view of the purpose of the law. Instead of looking to the spirit of the law, they decided that they would somehow find a letter of the law which faced the opposite way
much
and
safer.
Resulted in a conclusion which is absurd.
Much safer as judicial doctrine to look and see what the law says. Ask Raoul Berger.
Before we
I have heard Mr. Berger.
Before we run out of time, I want to go back to the Sharansky, Moynihan, Andrew Young foreign policy range of problems, which you talk about a great deal, and where we started and then got off onto other important questions. I'm concerned, for instance, about how you would deal with the importance of individual initiatives on the part of diplomats to express their concerns, as you supported Moynihan when he did it at the United Nations, and as you wrote in your book that you've been able to do it more, and how you would distinguish those concerns from some of the ones that you've expressed lately, where the statements made have been statements that you did not agree with. I see the Sharansky case is bringing it into focus because, as you know, I was very active for Sharansky while I was an American official, and sometimes said things that went beyond what was being said by higher officials because of the concern that I felt about that case and about other dissidents in the Soviet Union. Was I, in your view, acting improperly in expressing those views while I was a person in the government service? And if not, how do you then talk about the present situation that's agitated so many people involving Andrew Young?
The United Nations treaty specifies in crystal clear language that delegates to the United Nations shall take positions that represent the views of the President of the United States, and this is actually mentioned in the law, whose Secretary of State shall routinely communicate those instructions. Now, therefore, when Andrew Young says something as harrowing as his recent imputation that the massacre of the missionaries was a plot by Ian Smith, or that the United States is hardly to be distinguished from the Soviet Union in respect of political prisoners, it is extremely embarrassing to the President of the United States and violates the law. If you say to me, what kind of a reform ought we to have that permits the kind of license you exercised and Moynihan exercised, which, by the way, I like to think did not embarrass the President, since you didn't make preposterous statements, you made very sound statements, is one that would detach those emissaries in the United Nations from the formal diplomatic establishment and give them sort of a judge-like tenure. What we want in our human rights commissions are Roger Baldwins, not people who are not permitted to raise the subject of Cambodia because we're seeking détente with China. To mix human rights up with diplomacy is difficult enough as it is. To do so when there is a chain of authority that requires you to be dumb when you are technically engaged in trying to promote human rights is, I think, travesty.
Well,
go ahead. Sorry.
I was fishing over the past year and a half for a formulation that would satisfy both my feeling that your book states brilliantly what the problem is about having people sent there who are not supposed to be robots but are supposed to bring their own credentials and qualities, and then the dilemma we're put into when statements are made by pastors which in fact are statements which do not represent policy or which contradict what we would feel would be the most useful thing to do. How that line is drawn seems to me to carry implications far beyond the immediate situation in the United Nations.
I agree. And unfortunately, I've seen very little thinking about it. When you have a situation in which, in Cambodia, we have seen the greatest per capita slaughter in the history of probably of the world, and the Human Rights Commission takes 3 months to consider a petition to investigate the life in Cambodia, takes 3 months to turn down that petition, you can really ask yourself, has anybody got any reason at all to feel that anything at all has been accomplished by the idealistic enthusiasm that poured into the United Nations, resulting in all of those various covenants. But nobody that I know of is doing anything about it. You try to do something about it in Geneva, if I may say so, you failed.
Well,
it needs organic reform.
We got the discussion, which was important, I think, to have
that
discussion.
You got the discussion and it disappeared the day you left.
That's true. It disappeared because then there was the problem of follow-through afterwards, and that's a problem that I was very troubled by what Andrew Young said about that a few days ago, and I care about him very much, and people keep asking me if I think he should be fired, and I don't. I think perhaps he should be suspended for 5 days and he'll be fined $9,000 or something, but I can't see that if we fire people for statements which are not... I don't want to see us overreact to statements which are statements we do not agree with in a way which costs us that flexibility that I needed in Geneva to do anything at all.
The fact of the matter is the situation, if Eichmann were today practicing his trade in Algeria, you couldn't get a censure against him in the United Nations Human Rights Committee.
And I do think in Young's case that this last couple of remarks are really going far too far. I mean, Moynihan was certainly flamboyant, but as you said, he was basically furthering United States policy. And I think that Young's remark, putting it in the context of the Sharansky case and the violation of human rights in the Soviet Union, to say that it's similar in this country, was unbelievably destructive and counterproductive, embarrassed not only the president, I think this entire country. And I think that is grounds for hopefully his resignation, but if not, I think the president ought to have somebody who's going to be more reflective of American policy. I'm not sure we know what American policy is. I'm not sure Jimmy Carter knows what American policy is today, but we ought to have somebody who's not doing what Young did.
But is there any mechanism that you would approve of being used to dislodge him, or was that settled in the trial of Andrew Johnson?
Would you have voted for the resolution of impeachment in the House?
No, I think it's up to the president. I mean, I think he's the president's appointee, and I think the president should fire him if necessary.
But nobody else can.
I don't think, I think that's
I think you're right.
Violate,
as a as I think that was proved in yeah. the in that exactly. trial in Myers exactly. versus somebody.
No, I mean I, went, I think mean,
I find it difficult to be enthusiastic about firing anybody for something he has said, but I would like to turn
How about
to
Earl
the
Butts?
Whole question. Pardon me.
How about Earl Butts?
I would not fire people generally for what they say.
Generally. Oh, I can see why you're high price.
You see, if we had ERA, you could press that point.
But I would like to ask you something. You have indicated a very great disappointment, I guess would be the word, in the functioning of the United Nations and the Human Rights Commission and so forth. And some people might assume from that that you think, therefore, they should be abandoned. They're a poor thing, but they're all we've got. And I assume that you would think we ought to work on strengthening them rather than abandoning them, and sometimes you give the contrary impression.
Well, I don't think that the United Nations should be abandoned. In too many technical respects, it's useful. But I think that the idealistic agencies that we ought to either withdraw membership from them or insist on their reorganization in such a way as to have them reflect what it is that we desire. I don't believe that we should vote in the General Assembly, though.
See, I think that that's wrong. I really do. And I'd like to just say, focus back on that. I did finally resign because I found that there were so many things I wanted to say that I couldn't while there without doing the things that I think would have been irresponsible. But I do think Moynihan did some very valuable things staying there. And I think that it's very important to perceive that even with the disagreements, I feel that Andy's latest statements make it important to state that he's saying things that are simply not accurate and saying them in a context which is damaging things I care about. Nonetheless, he's done some very useful things in the United Nations by being able to deal with a lot of places that we wrote
Has he made the trains run on time in the end?
The point I'm trying to focus on is that if we were to not focus on an effort to change the United Nations for the better, we would still have the United Nations to deal with. The question seems to me is, why don't we do more about making sure that we're neither supine nor withdrawing at UN bodies? And in doing that, we could, I think, affect the shape of the United Nations in a way which would make it less objectionable and questionable.
I'm all for it. When you become president, I hope you will proceed to do it.
Would you accept an appointment to the UN if I let you say what you want?
May I ask you a totally unrelated question? I have no idea really how you stand on the general question of the Federal Communications Commission and the power that it exercises over broadcasters. I would be interested in knowing, for example, how you feel about the recent decision about the 12 dirty words which cannot be said on daytime radio, or at least so the Federal Communications Commission said, and so the Supreme Court said they could say. I'd be interested in knowing...
Oh, we have only a second, so let me attempt a quick answer. I think that these community exercises the same rights it exercises against obscenities being sprawled in a public building. But by and large, I would prefer an FCC whose reforms gave rights to its proprietors, subject only to that public nuisance consideration, which I think it is a legitimate concern of the community. Thank you, Mr. Carter Burden. Thank you, Mrs. Pilpel. Thank you, Mr. Lowenstein.
Printed bound transcript of this program, send $1 to Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina 29250. Indicate the subject of the program and please allow 3 weeks for delivery. This program was produced by SECA, which is solely responsible for its content. Funding was provided by this station and by other public television stations.